in this particular course of foundation engineering. And this foundation engineering, to be specific, if you have gone through your curriculum, I'm not sure, because one cannot become a civil engineer without having a proper understanding even about what is called as foundation engineering. And the syllabus of this particular course is the exact continuation of where we have stopped in our soil mechanics. In our soil mechanics, we have understood what are the properties of the soil and how do we determine the various properties of the soil. It could be index properties or in the are the engineering properties. And then we have talked about the stability of slopes. How do we design the slopes, or how do we understand whether the given slope is a stable slope or not, depending on the factor of safety of that slope. We have understood that. And to continue from there, where we have stopped our discussion, we will continue our discussion with the topic what is called as earth pressure. Okay, so in this topic of earth pressure, we are going to be coming across with different states at which the soil is going to be existing, where the soil would be there at a state of what is called as at rest condition, active condition, and a passive condition. So why is this earth pressure concept something important? Means always you may not have the required area for constructing a proper slope to change your elevation from higher level to that of your lower level. The ground cannot be changed with a proper sloping elevation. Always it may not be possible to have such huge slopes constructed. So in such particular cases, we might be forced to construct the slopes with almost vertical condition. So when you want to construct the slopes almost with a stable condition and to be more or less vertical, or with the steeper sloping conditions, so in such particular slopes, the slopes would under natural state, the slopes would be mostly unstable. So in such particular cases, we go on to construct some structure, what is called as a retaining structure. The purpose of that retaining structure is to retain the soil at different elevations. On one side of that structure, you'll have the soil at a higher elevation. On the other side of that structure, you'll have the soil at a lower elevation. So when the soil is in those respective states, how much is the pressure exerted by that particular soil on that so-called structure, what is retaining the soil there, is what we are going to be completely understanding from your first unit. And coming to the second unit, we are going to be talking about what is called as geotechnical investigations. So geotechnical investigation, in the sense, in the previous course we said, okay, we'll be collecting the soil sample from the field, we'll go to the lab, and we'll subsequently perform the required test to determine the properties of the soil. But in the process of collecting the soil from the field, how do we collect that soil sample? What are the different methods or mechanisms by which we'll be collecting the soil sample? And by which method we'll be collecting what is called as a disturbed soil sample, we'll be collecting what is called as undisturbed soil sample. And at what different depths I should collect the soil sample. And within that particular construction site, what is the different positions where I should be collecting the soil sample. All such information we'll be trying to understand from this particular topic, what is called as geotechnical investigation. And in the process, if I want to understand the ground condition at a particular site, what should be the depth till which I should know the properties of the soil? That all we'll be trying to talk about. And how do we locate the position of a water table? All that we'll be covering in this particular topic, that is geotechnical investigation. And in previous course, soil mechanics, we were talking purely about our lab tests. It could be your consolidation test, it could be permeability test, it could be any other test that we have talked about. All of them are lab tests. Now, coming to this particular course, we'll be focusing on what is called as your field test, or in-situ tests also we'll be trying to look at in the geotechnical investigation topic. Okay, so that all we'll be covering in the first part of your second unit. And coming to the second part of your second unit, we'll be trying to talk about stresses that are getting developed in your soils. Earlier in the soil mechanics course also, we have talked about the stresses that are getting developed in the soil. But that was due to the effect of gravity only. Due to the effect of gravity stresses, that's nothing but because of the self-weight of the soil, we have talked about the stresses that were getting developed in the soil. But in this particular course, due to your external structure, the load coming from the external structure, which is getting transferred onto the soil through the foundation. Now, once the load which is coming from the foundation onto the soil, what is that load trying to do in that particular soil? It is generating an additional stress in the soil. Earlier, we have seen how to calculate the stress because of the self-weight of the soil. Now, in addition to that particular self-weight condition, you also have some external loading which is coming from the superstructure through the foundation onto the soil. So, because of that loading, how much is the additional stress that is getting developed in the soil is what we are going to be looking at. Okay, so we'll be mostly focusing on how to calculate that stress distribution in the soil based on Bosnick's theory. And we have also got other theory by which you will be calculating the stresses in the soil, which is Westergaard's theory, but we'll not be focusing much about Westergaard's theory. Our main focus, our complete focus would be with respect to Bosnick's theory. In the case of different loading conditions, where it can be a point load, it can be a UDL or a line load, taking into consideration of different aspects of geotechnical engineering structures that we come across. So depending on all such considerations, we'll try to look at how the loading is coming from the foundation onto the soil, and for the different cases of loading conditions, how the stresses are getting developed in the soil additionally because of your superstructural load. That's all what we will be covering in this second part of the second unit. And coming to your third unit, we'll start exactly introducing what is meant by foundations from here. And we'll broadly understand how do we classify these foundations as shallow foundation and deep foundation. And when do we need to go for what is called as a shallow foundation? When do we need to go for deep foundation? In which soil condition, which type of foundation is suitable? All that we'll be trying to talk about in the introduction to foundation. And then we further move on to understand in detail relatively about what is called as shallow foundation in the third unit. So in the case of a shallow foundation, how do we understand or how do we theoretically determine the bearing capacity of the foundation? Okay. So we have got different theories by which we can go on to determine the bearing capacity of your shallow foundation. To start with, basically, we'll start with what is called as Terzaghi's theory for estimating the bearing capacity of the foundation, taking into consideration of different aspects like shape of the foundation, depth of the foundation, effect of water table, and all those aspects we'll be taking into consideration. And whether it is a vertical load passing through the CG of the foundation, or whether it is a vertical load which has got some eccentricity, or whether it is an inclined load. So taking into all those aspects, we'll try to understand how to estimate the bearing capacity of your shallow foundation. Now, apart from Terzaghi's theory also, we'll be trying to talk about how to estimate the bearing capacity of your shallow foundation based on other theories which are prominently used in the estimation of the bearing capacity, like it could be Wessick's theory or Mehrhoff's theory or Hansen's theory, or as per Indian standard code, how do we estimate the bearing capacity? We'll be trying to certainly cover in this particular topic of shallow foundation. And we start with what is called as isolated footing in the shallow foundation, and then we'll try to also have a insight into what is called as combined footing also. Okay, combined footing, we'll try to understand in detail what is that combined footing or isolated footing and so on. So as we go on with the course, we'll be able to understand all those aspects what we'll be talking about. That's all. And subsequently, we'll also be seeing how to estimate the settlements in the case of your shallow foundation due to the load what is coming from your superstructure, and also taking into consideration of the effect of your soil. So in the estimation of settlements, we'll be trying to talk about what is called as immediate settlement. We'll be trying to talk about what is called as primary consolidation settlement and secondary compression settlement. So whatever the settlement aspects that we have talked in our previous course, that is consolidation, in the same way we'll be trying to estimate the settlements in the foundation, because settlement in the soil is nothing but it is equal to the settlement in your foundation, but with small addition which is getting added now here is your immediate settlement term, because earlier in the case of clay soil deposits, we have not focused on what is called as immediate settlement. We said in the case of clay soil deposits, that so-called consolidation effect, which is predominantly seen in clay soil, where we'll be focusing mostly on what is called as primary consolidation settlement and subsequently the secondary compression settlement because of your creep effect. Here, when we start talking about your settlements in the foundation, we also talk about that additional settlement, which is immediate settlement. To start with, once the load is applied from the foundation onto the soil, immediately the amount of settlement what you are coming across in the foundation is what is called as immediate settlement. Over a period of time, then we start coming across with the primary consolidation settlement and the subsequent secondary compression settlement, which is otherwise called as creep settlement. So that's all what we'll be covering broadly in our third unit. And coming to the fourth unit, we'll be mainly focusing on, in the third unit, we are focusing on what is called as shallow foundation. And in fourth and fifth unit, we'll be mostly focusing on what is called as a deep foundation. And the major deep foundation, what we'll be most commonly talking about in residential structures or even in the high-rise buildings, okay? So are nothing but your pile foundation. Pile foundation is one type of deep foundation. So our unit 4 will be mainly focusing on what is called as pile foundations. Okay. So where we'll be trying to talk about how to estimate the load carrying capacity of your pile foundation. So in the process, first we understand how much is load carried by an individual pile, and then we go on to calculate how much is the load carried by group of piles existing in that particular pile foundation. Okay, so and in the process of estimating, we'll also be not just only talking about the load carrying capacity, which is nothing but bearing capacity of that pile foundation. We'll also be seeing how much is the settlement that your pile foundation would undergo depending on the load which is coming onto that particular pile foundation due to the superstructure. That also we'll be trying to focus in our fourth unit. And coming to the fifth unit, we'll be focusing on, as I mentioned, like other aspects of your deep foundation. That's your caisson foundation, which is otherwise also called as well foundation. Okay, so that's another type of deep foundation which is typically adopted in the case of your bridge piers. So we'll be talking about the other type of your deep foundation in your unit 5, that is your caissons. And we'll also be talking about what is called as cofferdam. Cofferdam is nothing but typically a temporary structure what you construct in the areas where you have water flowing existing. Because let's say, for example, I want to construct a foundation for a bridge where you have water flowing through that particular region 365 days. Now, in such particular case, how do I construct a foundation? Because it would be difficult to construct a foundation in that particular region when the water is flowing through that area. So what I should do is, first I should divert the direction of water, or wherever I want to construct my foundation, I should not allow the water to flow through that area. So for creating such environment where water is not going to be flowing through that particular region, we go on to construct what is called as a temporary structure, which is called as cofferdam. So by constructing that cofferdam, we divert the direction of water, and then we create a temporary dry area there. And in that area, we go on to construct your typical foundation that is required for your structure there. That's all what we'll be covering under, that is all what we'll look at in cofferdam. How to construct, what are the different types of cofferdams are there, and so on. In which case, which is suitable, and so on, we'll be focusing on. And another topic what we'll be covering in unit 5 is underpinning. Underpinning, what is mean by underpinning, and when do we need to go for underpinning, and so on. So underpinning is nothing but it's a process or a mechanism by which you are trying to improve the condition of the foundation, or improve the condition of your superstructure, which is already existing, or which is to be constructed. Okay, so in case, let's say, for example, you have some railway bridges which are constructed some 50, 60 years before, and now the condition of those bridges is not that much suitable to carry the load which is coming from your railway track when your trains are moving over it. I mean, in such particular case, you cannot immediately go on to construct your another bridge there. So, but however, you can look after the alternatives to improve the condition of the bridge there or any abutment existing there. So, such techniques is what we call it as your underpinning. So, you are going to improve the condition of the existing structure or existing foundation or the existing soil. So, that process of improving the condition, okay, is what we call it as underpinning. Underpinning is nothing but it's a technique. Okay. Next, the other topic what we'll be covering is geosynthetics. Because in existing condition of the soil, sometimes the soil may not be suitable for taking up the construction there. But however, you are forced to take up the construction. So you have to see for different alternative techniques by which you can improve the soil condition and then subsequently go for the construction there. So that different techniques that one is widely being used, either in the aspects of geotechnical engineering or in the aspects of your transportation engineering, that in the construction of your highways, or even in some aspects of structural engineering or some aspects of your environmental engineering, where you are required to construct what is called as your where you want to have proper sewage disposal areas without contaminating the ground condition there. So in all such particular cases, we come across with the usage of what is called as geosynthetics. And in the case of your hydraulic constructions, also hydraulic structures, maybe it could be your canal linings, or in the construction of your embankments. Okay, so wherever, in almost in majority of the civil engineering applications, we have got this geosynthetics playing a major role in redefining the properties, in improving the properties of that soil or the ground. Okay, so that's all what we'll be talking about in geosynthetics. What are the different types of geosynthetics that are available, and what is the use of different types of geosynthetics, in which condition which type of geosynthetic is used for improving what parameter of the soil. Sometimes I might be required to improve the permeability of the soil, sometimes I might be required to improve the load carrying capacity of the soil, sometimes I would be required to decrease the settlements in the soil. Okay, so depending on your requirement, we'll be looking at different types of geosynthetics which can be used, and we'll understand their applications and their functions and how those geosynthetics are classified depending on their functionality. All that we'll be talking about in the fifth unit. So this is all about your syllabus, what we'll be covering in this foundation engineering course. And the books what we can refer to as of this particular course is concerned, Principles of Foundation Engineering by B.M. Das. Earlier was Principles of Geotechnical Engineering by B.M. Das, same thing. But here it's the Foundation Engineering, Principles of Foundation Engineering, which we are going to be following for this Foundation Engineering course, which is given by B.M. Das. Or the other book which we have also referred in our Soil Mechanics course, that is Basics and Basic and Applied Soil Mechanics by Gopal Ranjan and A.S.R. Rao. So the same book can also be used for this foundation engineering course. In addition to that, those who are interested in learning the concepts very much in detail, B.M. Das book would be sufficient enough. But additionally also, you can refer to this book, that is Foundation Analysis and Design by J.E. Bowles. Okay, very standard book. So you can also refer to that particular book for this foundation engineering course. So this is all about the content what we'll be covering in this course, and the references for this particular course.